We will now talk about how this issue of zeros in randomized algorithms can be addressed, and it's not a minor annoyance, it's actually a serious issue, because randomized algorithms do not work, do not like working with these zeros. We will now learn how to deal with zeros in the profile matrix. And in real world, there is always a possibility that we do not observe one of the possible events. In this case, we assign them empirical probability zero. But in fact, their real probability is not zero. It's simply the size of our sample is too small. And randomized algorithms hate zeros because it affects their performance in a serious way. That's why we need to learn how to get rid of zeros. Fortunately, Laplace helped us to figure out how to do this. Laplace calculated the probability that the sun will not rise tomorrow, given the fact that it has risen in the last 5,000 years. And actually, this probability is roughly 1 in 2 million, according to Laplace. His estimate was ridiculed because his opponent didn't realize how important this calculation was. Now, so if we repeat an experiment that can result in a success or a failure n times and get s successes, then what is the probability that the next repetition will be a success? In other words, if x1, x2, xn plus 1 are conditionally independent random variables, Boolean random variables where failure corresponds to zero and success corresponds to one, that traditional way to compute probability of xn plus 1 is simply compute the fraction on successes among all trials. So it will be s divided by n. However, since we have a prior knowledge that successes and failures exist, then we actually had two more observations implicitly, even before we started our trials. So even before we started our trials, we should acknowledge that success and failure are possible, and therefore there are two more invisible events. That was Laplace's argument, and therefore he made a correction based on the fact that when we see n events, we actually see n plus 2 events, and when we see s successes, we actually see s plus 1 successes, and the formula changed to s plus 1 divided to n plus 2. It may sound counterintuitive, but let's see how Laplace would get rid of zeros in the profile matrix. So in this case, what we need to do to update the profile matrix to get rid of zero? According to the Laplace rule of succession, we should assume a possibility that every event represented in the profile matrix can occur. And therefore, we should add once to every entry of profile matrix. And here I show how Laplace would update the count matrix by adding once to all entries. As a result, profile matrix also will get updated, all probabilities will get updated, and we will get rid of all zeros in probability. Now, instead of rolling one-sided dice, we can actually roll seven-sided dice. And based on the result of seven-sided dice, we will choose a new instance of the motif in the sequence. Here it is. Afterwards, we iterate, and let's see how our motifs are changing. So starting from this, we once again continue with Gibbs sampler, remove one of the sequences, form motif matrix, build count matrix, update it with pseudo counts by adding ones to every entry, compute profile matrix once again, compute probability of every k-mer, and once again roll seven-sided dice. The seven-sided dice leads to changing once again one of the choices of our motif, and we start a new iteration. Again, we randomly remove one of the sequences, construct count matrix, apply Laplace rule of succession, create profile, calculate probability, again roll seven-sided dice, and we arrive to the, once again, starting from completely random motif, in just three iterations, we almost captured the correct implanted motifs, which means that the bias that implanted motif introduced was correctly captured by Gibbs sampler and led us to the correct motif. We are not still there because in the second sequence, we have not found the correct motif yet, but surely at the next iteration with high probability, we'll find it. So we are almost done with covering a randomized algorithm, but the challenge of predicting degenerative signal remains. Remember, our randomized motif search did not find the perfect binding sites for this motif. What can we do? Well, there is one possibility. Maybe we can develop even better algorithm for finding motifs. But if you think about this, imagine that you insert not motif of length 15 with four mutations, but motif of length 15 with five mutations. Finding this motif is almost impossible, not because we don't have efficient algorithms, but because random motifs start competing with real motifs. Simply statistically, it may not be possible to find these motifs if we implant them in long DNA strings, for example, into strings of length 1,000. What can be done? Should we give up in this case? Biologists did not give up. And the way to solve this problem today is to resort to the techniques which is called chip sequencing. And essentially what chip sequencing does, it reduces the length of DNA string to look for regulatory motifs. As I mentioned, when you insert elusive pattern in the strings of length 1,000, it may not be possible even to find it even with the best available algorithm. But if biologists reduced the area where to look for motif, let's say from 1,000 to 100, then suddenly statistics work in our favor and we can find such motifs. And this is the end of the story about randomized algorithms.